represent a very real threat. It's yet another example of companies trying to cover themselves in greenwash, pretending that this is yet another solution to the climate crisis that we face. It's yet another dead end, it's yet another diversion, and I think we need to be very clear that the only thing that's green about it is the colour of the money that appears to be associated with it. The thing I wanted to talk about really was just some of the threats and some of the issues that I've tried to bring up with the government related to the threats associated with fracking, and which have been pretty much picked into touch so far. So we need a much bigger campaign and much more pressure on the government to get it to act. But it's notable, I think, for example, that there's still an ongoing US Environmental Protection Agency investigation into the potential impact on water quality and public health from fracking, which is due to report in 2012. And one might have hoped that a government that says it's the greenest ever, cough, cough, might have waited until the results of that impact assessment were known, for example, but not a bit of it. We're still ploughing ahead in this country. And so you'll know that the company Quadrilla has licenses for four sites in Lancashire, all of which were given formal approval by the government. And Energy Minister Charles Hendry has said publicly that he supports fracking. He's also said, in reply to a written parliamentary question that I put to him, that in the UK, shale gas has not yet been commercially proven. So he's supporting something in a very gun-ho way, at the same time as admitting it's actually not been proven in any serious way at all. Quadrilla recently suspended exploratory operations because of two earthquakes near its sites in Blackpool, and has said that the Energy and Climate Change Department will be involved in any decision to resume. Now that might sound like a positive pause, if you like, but DEC does seem pretty relaxed on the whole thing. Again, an answer to another parliamentary question, they claim, and I quote, "There is a strong regulatory safety and environmental regime in place, administered by the Health and Safety Executive, local authorities and relevant environmental agencies to ensure that potential risks to safety or the environment are properly managed. On the basis of available information, the department sees no need for a moratorium on shale gas activities in the UK." Now that's quite interesting wording, on the basis of available information. I mean, if you've got a government that puts its head in the sand and doesn't look for any information, it may well be that on the basis of kind of no information, the department sees no need for a moratorium. But if it were taking its job seriously, it would be looking at that information, that mountain information out there, which suggests that there are very real environmental risks associated with fracking. You only need to look at what's been happening in the US, for example, as well as the water contamination problems that have been widely reported in the US. There's also a risk of well blowouts. That's already happened twice in the US, including one occasion where natural gas and drilling fluids were shot 23 metres into the air. It's not just the pollution, though, it's also the use, yet more use, of finite resources or scarce resources. Shale gas production is very water intensive as well. Estimates vary, with one report stating that each well would use 91,000 cubic metres of water, another putting it at a lower figure, between 9,000 and 29,000 cubic metres will be needed. But to put that into perspective, an Olympic swimming pool holds an average of just 2,500 cubic metres of water. What we're talking about here is anywhere between 9,000 and 91,000. For each well. And that kind of uncertainty is common regarding fracking, the impact and potential of which are simply still not understood. And indeed, even the Energy Minister, Charles Hendry, uses phrases like "it's too early to make estimates" or "it's speculative." And so I think it is deeply irresponsible for a department which will acknowledge when pushed that actually we know very little about this technology, to be at the same time giving its wholehearted support to it. Rather than adopting a precautionary approach that one might have hoped for, instead what we're having is a government which is basically encouraging a technology, taking what could be unacceptable risks with both the safety of our environment and nearby communities. Just a few more examples. Disposing of the fracking fluids, which are highly saline, contaminated with chemicals and a high mineral content, is yet another potential environmental hazard. And in the US, known carcinogens and heavy metals are used in fracking, and because of the large quantities involved, the risk of contamination is very high. Now, hydraulic fracturing technology was developed by Halliburton back in the 1940s. That's the same Halliburton that is closely linked with former US Secretary of Defense and Vice President Dick Cheney, and has in the past been charged with bribery, corruption, serious irregularities in connection with contracts in, for example, Iraq, Nigeria, and Afghanistan. And it's Halliburton that are forging ahead with fracking in the US, and who successfully lobbied for a loophole in the 2005 energy bill, which exempted natural gas drilling from the Safe Drinking Water Act and companies from disclosing the chemicals used during hydraulic fracturing. It's Halliburton too that claim that they've invented a green fracking fluid, yet still refuses to completely disclose which chemicals are being used at which of its wells so that communities can better protect themselves. So this greenwash essentially continues, and on both sides of the Atlantic, fracking technology is being promoted by some as an alternative to coal, even though there's very little known about its carbon footprint or potential supplies of shale gas. Charles Hendry again, in a reply to a written question, says, "I have made no assessment of greenhouse gas emissions of shale gas-related extraction." Marvellous. So the evidence from the US is that shale gas is being used simply to meet more and more energy demands rather than to save energy. And as I'm sure Kevin will say from the Tyndall Centre, there's very little to suggest that shale gas will play a key role in any kind of transition as a transition fuel in the move to a low carbon economy.